So I just wanted to kind of.
Okay, sure.
So we're gonna discuss the organization.
Doing the print as a word. Doing some very important. So. It's beautifully clean.
So where do we, when's it on,
file these? When they're all done. So they go in the paperwork.
There's a few of the outcomes, and as I mentioned.
Why do they go in here and then like, you put the. You connect them basically. Put it in there. I seen it.
I mean, that's not necessarily that's rare, but. Yeah, it does happen, but it's rare, I guess.
Yeah.
Somebody actually told me that you guys have gone to places and they didn't even exist.
That happens, that, yeah, yeah. So, I mean, there's stuff out there that happens.
It's amazing, right? What people do.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm amazed what they'll try to ask me to do.
Yeah,
so I like my legs.
Sorry.
Go down the street and see if you can find somebody else. There it is. I just didn't see it when it came in.
Oh, you found it. Yeah.
Yeah, so I just want to be able to make sure that everything is tidy and that if there's anything out of the ordinary or that needs to be fixed, that I'm able to call you. Correct.
Tighten up the ship.
Exactly. Yeah. That makes my job a lot easier. So we'll hold the interview. It might take 2 hours at the most. Usually it's about an hour. There's quite a few questions. Some are general questions that we ask every organization, and some are just specific to your ministry story. And then tomorrow and Thursday, I'll review the receipts from the financial records and double check that with the accuracy of the return. And then before I leave on Thursday, we can sit down and discuss any issues and then what the next steps may be. So I want to make time at the end of the interview just to answer any questions that we might have. We can always take a break if needed. Sometimes it goes long and you just step out, that's fine. And then let me know if I need to clarify any questions. If you're not sure, you can always come back to something if you're like, oh, wait. Now I remember, whatever.
Okay. And it's okay to have, if I do this or that, I've got vows here to represent me.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, so they always do the initial interview just so they can meet you and make sure you exist. And, if you're going to ask questions, I'm not going to quite know the answer to, as far as how it day to day and how it runs.
Right.
But it should be pretty sure.
Yeah.
Nothing that you won't know the answer to.
Just a reminder, we do have a restroom.
So you do the same thing.
Oh, yeah, it was. I tried to go out.
And they're separate, but they go in the same.
Oh,
okay. And it used to
the
go
same
when
room.
Okay. Yes.
Because it's the same date. And then for.
So I can start?
For this one.
Valerie
Houston, source 1 2.
Yeah, oh, he does. I'm asking you this one.
Oh, I have a copy.
You can either leave it in here since it's
okay.
Big
enough.
Yeah, I have a
put
copy
a blank
in the
paper
thing.
And start over.
Oh,
yeah.
I'll look and see. It should be here.
So when you come for lunch, you need to sign in. Yeah, they always have to sign in. And then for the volunteer one, I have this same thing.
Oh, what did I provide?
You're doing it.
Sorry, I'm copying files.
Grab the paper, cut it, poke a hole in it like that, and then you'll put it in this one. Okay. And then this one is the same thing you did it from for the whole year. And then it's all, so you just keep this. We need a bigger binder for this. So that it all fits, and then you just slid it in so it's passed by David. And they want to do the same thing. And you gotta make sure that they always do it. It's always signed and then it's always put in there. And then that one's that one, and it has to have volunteer signing. And then this one. This one is the volunteer. You'll tell them what kind of volunteer we're offering. So cleaning, medical, driver's test, office related.
So then it gives us a month and it doesn't
work. Wherever needed is most. And then
make copies of them.
Community service or help or wanting to volunteer, they have to fill it out.
Yep.
And then they just fill it out, make sure they always pick a date so that we know when they came in. And then make sure this is always filled out. And then you have them, what areas would you like most, and then make sure they always have a good emergency contact.
Not we're aware of.
And that's this form.
You started as a street outreach.
This one, we can change this one if you want.
We were watching
this one. But we put this because it was open. This one is the donor receipt one.
And we had some about 5 or 6 guitar.
So these ones are all the ones that are donor receipts. So at least you have all the receipts in there, and then it's always has to be filled out, the date. Now, your signature, their signature, and you get a copy, and you get this one.
We still do street outreach today.
This one is right here.
That has changed. Sometimes we're more, sometimes less. So we remain with the evangelism. We started moved out of the houses, going from house to house. And when office spaces began to grow,
all community service papers.
Formalized with the IRS in June or July of 91.
And then they all have to be updated to give them a copy. Make sure the reserves are taken. Make sure
I think so,
make sure you're always writing the description of the work and then comments.
And then
the total hours, of course. And then sometimes the last one.
So they bring this paper.
They're supposed to bring this paper.
I remember when that was, but somebody went by me of a building that was a big away.
They'll ask, well, can you take a picture of it and email it to my community service? So they email to their community service paper will always be on it.
Right.
From Jefferson. I don't know about Denver or anything.
We were there for several years.
If you can't do it for like these type of programs. Then you just make a copy.
Yeah, we were there.
Just send it to them. You always keep a copy. We just
fixed the place that, and we had a little kitchen that used to be apartment units. And the land was first parcel during the Civil War.
You could just write completed, and you write their situation. If they can't make it, or they don't want to come, or refuse to do work, or don't want to come back, or you just write it on there.
So the soup kitchen. As
and that's how we do that community service, and then
so we fed people. People came of all kinds of needs, and that's just kind of flowing into this facility. But before we got here, we were downtown. So as it grew, we began to take care of people's needs, which is part of our mission statement. To meet the needs of mind, spirit, soul, and body. So in purpose, of course, is to...
Oh, it's still there. It's over there.
Okay.
So we were there for several years. Then the city of Port Chris.
And this is their person.
Yeah, their person.
Wanting to build a museum down there in Colorado. So then when that woman approached with that, we then went from there to another location that was open to the community.
I was staying there a couple weeks ago, and I was wondering if I left if I had any mail.
So it was only for a short period of time because they didn't have a kitchen.
Let me get right with you.
But we were able to make
and so I can know what you're doing with your community services. They say, I already completed my community service. You're right here, completed community service with someone else. And then they say, make sure we rely on them coming in. They don't show up. If they don't show up in 2 to 3 weeks, and they told us they were coming, call back and say, So eventually we were running there and trying to fix this up. So long story short, it's taking about 7 years to get it for right now. Yes. So now we're back in our super kitchen for people up in Shelton, evangelizing going out of the streets. Our social pastor's wife has been downtown. Now they go and they take food to homeless people.
And these are
people. We also feed them here. For some time, we would be every day here. It depends on the season, the time. Right now, they go Wednesday, Fridays.
And they're dated, so if you have any needs, you make Saturdays.
We've been doing church on Sundays for quite a while now. Because people have been asking us, we have a service, I want to go to Bible study. So we get Bible study on Friday nights. So it's just expanded our mission.
Christmas tree tribe comes and say, okay.
get reclassified as a church club, because I don't know how, or I haven't had time.
Okay, so that's something we can look at.
Okay.
But there are some very specific rules and regulations about having a church.
And it's all informal, because we haven't reclassified, so we stay to 501(c)(3).
Oh, this was the thing that they would, that we would have everybody sign for their kids or something, they come. Yeah, so this was documented, so, no, we'll just keep.
We do our soup kitchen.
As much as we get more of these.
Yeah.
So we provide the meals, we provide the breakfast and lunch, we charge most meals, we don't charge you for anything.
So, they went shopping.
So you'll see all that, so we have a clothing bank.
For like reimbursement or something. You'll take a copy, yeah, you'll take a copy and you'll put it on here. And then, so receive it, and then, if they forget or something, and they're in the, you remind it, remind them.
Then the food we go to get from there, we built up quite a.
Okay.
I'm sorry, just like you, but my pregnant girlfriend's in the car.
Okay.
There's 10 number 3, which is the first ticket I'm supposed to get.
And then sometimes.
So if it should, if it should be in the mailbox?
Yeah, I don't have a key in there, she's sent me that.
Okay, so, once Pastor sees an important meeting, we'll have someone go, which would only be him.
Alright, thank you.
And as far as east is Colorado Boulevard, then as far as people.
That's what I think.
So we consider that our food effort, so, and then we have a food bank in the back, food pantry. We have the food pantry, the soup kitchen, hot lunches, breakfast.
Will always be right here.
And most of the services that we do, by the city center, that's part of our goal, to teach the gospel.
We just put a bunch of flyers on here, like application flyers.
This is Doug.
Oh, yeah, oh, it does.
There's 3D, I'm crazy.
Statement on that is this, they'll come in, they might, their hygiene will be really bad, but we take them.
And then, so you can either keep this. On there and do it how like we did it, and just live it, or you can do it yourself and just rip them off, and then hang them right here and just write it, either way.
So, this one's for the volunteers, this one's for the lunch.
These ones are for.
I'll say pre-COVID, we were getting easily, maybe 2,000 easily, and sometimes, because it's real busy. We got our average, Thanksgiving average, you can't ever see, we all done that for 27 years. And we had that award at the show, but we had the most on that one, 25,000. Yes, so we've done that every year. Let's see if I got it in the folder, I don't wanna show you this. We just got this from the city of Denver, and I want you to look at it, because it shows you some history. I just got that, I just sent that to Val. But that was awarded by the mayor just the other day. And you can have that copy. Yes.
Oh, perfect.
That shows you the history of what we do, so, the food bank here, it can fluctuate, you know, 6 to 150, just depending on the day, when you're in.
Yeah.
But there's always somebody, but as far as the big ones.
You keep this one?
And you have a receipt.
And you hang this one, yeah.
But there's been some miracles, I can tell you, one time we did a big pot of stew, and the people kept coming and coming and coming, and it never ended. So, kinda like, what was it, the widow woman feeding Elijah.
Yeah.
They wanted us to use it for Christmas, but we just took it just in case.
We find out, because we have both homeless and non-homeless, everybody's gonna need a state, that comes here. We find out if they're homeless, we try to find ready-to-eat foods, like hot dog cans, sausages. sandwiches or something like that. Sometimes we have to prepare stuff for them. Sometimes we don't have it. Sometimes we have to see if we can procure it and then get it. But for the most part, we try to, the ladies up here, they'll fill out cards. So we first of all determine what their need is and what they're able to handle. And then we provide them what we have. Sometimes we'll ask for something specific. And if we don't have it, we'll try to provide a substitute or anything like that. We'll just say this is what we do.
She's wanted to make that, so we kept it the night shelter. We kept it right here.
And for the most part, we try to do at least one box a week.
And then we're on the application for LEAP. Those ones right there?
No, those are for Social Security.
Oh, Social Security.
Oh, hard.
Social Security.
And you always have new people in the mix with that. It's by word of mouth.
The
homeless population has definitely increased exponentially.
And people are looking at them, and they bring out his brochures, they're all in the brown
There's
flyers,
these little snacks,
if you ever run out,
food boxes, we provide clothing,
food bank jars,
we're busy. It affected us, in my opinion, because we had an increase of need. It just seems like there were more people in need. It affected us because our food pantry was depleted many times.
That's if you run over there and then they're right here.
Like I said, like the miracles of it.
And then I tried to do something so that just in case they're ready.
Initially,
I was
being tired.
For a short period of time, we had people come to the back gate. We were learning as everybody else with the mask and the gloves and dealing with it. But after the first couple of weeks, maybe even a month at the very most, I think maybe the first week we shut everything down. We didn't know what to do. But that was brief, and we continued operations. We continued feeding people, and as people found out we were still open, more people came by word of mouth. We found that some stores were closed, so we had to go buy food and get food where we could.
Old messages and receipts.
So we obtained food and meals however we could to
offset the
shortages.
Paper clips and et cetera right there, gloves, books. Pencil sharpener.
Somebody stole the pens. I've seen that.
They took all the pens and and then so.
We had people come into the facility that said, I've been working a job for 10 years. I lost it. My family, I'm embarrassed to come here. Anybody's tears in their eyes. We said, look, you're welcome. We don't care who you are, where you come from. So we also fed not just the needy, the homeless. We fed those that were in the structure of regular families. And so they faced mitigating circumstances that they needed a solution to. So we provided that solution and the Lord provided for us in different ways. That I'm sure is just an impact to everyone. I'm saying that it's increasing again. There is it's they're coming back, people getting brave, so to speak.
Yeah.
Although there was an increase in from that time, it's starting to increase
on
more.
Tuesdays, Thursdays, it's still 12.
Tuesdays and Thursdays,
yes.
We don't do this.
And I hope we don't do this.
No.
Yes.
Okay.
Maybe.
It's only through the.
No, this one.
The lunch.
Yes, so Tuesdays and Thursdays, and Thursdays.
That's even happening at Stride, because I think the people that you always have to wear a mask, and now they're just
you can leave it right here.
It's like a lot of healthcare.
Same thing, it goes in.
Yeah.
So there were
still
And then Tuesdays, Thursdays, and Wednesdays is Wednesdays. And then if anybody's volunteering outside of the place, they have to have this other shop sign us.
So, a lot of your, it sounds like a lot of it is done through word of mouth, but do you do any advertising or?
Oh, we have. I've used a couple of these flyers. We've distributed flyers. We have a schedule on the front desk that we use to let them know that we're open, with the hours of operation on it.
Vacuum it, wipe everything down.
Some advertising through signs, some through social media.
Say like it gets a long time and there's like.
But for the most part, I would say it's.
Then we move everything and just get behind there and wipe it down.
Okay, so can you tell me about your annual Thanksgiving?
Yes, it started in 1995 in November, and it started out of our building on Battle Street, 1240 Battle.
Oh, yeah.
We had
seven to ten
ladies showed up, and me and another guy. And we didn't know how it was going to work out. We do it. We started, I think, the second or third Saturday of November, or we did it on the second Saturday of November because we're first out the gate and we like to serve the Thanksgiving meal right off the bat. So it started with 7 turkeys, 7 to 10 volunteers, and 250 people showed up in the parking lot. It grew from there into to where we had no more room for the parking lot next to us in the building on Banner, until it overflowed.
And then you'll just listen to
and there's a line all the way down the block
end,
to the art museum.
So you have your message book to write down.
Where
the
what is now called the Kicker Steel Museum to
the
art museum.
The message and
the line wrapped all the way
what
around.
Needs to
so
be done, and
then we applied for a permit, asked to see
if you
can hold it in the street, and then
if you need to go back, you'll save
that.
If
then
you already wrote down it in the
museum,
you'll delete it. If it's really important, like someone harassing,
I'll just give you a little insight here.
We're
having a problem with the homeless
people. So
someone's
harassing, I
know
it's safe to
have. So then we asked the city to have it in front of the city hall.
You'll save them.
And so we've been with the city ever since. I don't know when we first started there, but we've been there for with the city for, I would say, at least.
The important messages, like if
so the Thanksgiving outreach is been around
right,
since 95, how many years is it?
All the work messages down, taking down and then delete them.
Right.
And then you'll call, like you'll answer questions like this one, food delivery.
So we got a favor with the city.
And
we got a permit
able
to close
to
it
go
down.
And deliver.
And the only time that it closed down, in front of the city hall was actually 2020 when the COVID pandemic.
And you'll say, okay, well, what's your address? Where you're at?
So what we did was we had it in the backyard.
Yep,
we did. And
if
they came. And then we had it last year in the backyard because a lot of my vendors that I used to have went out of business. So the plan is with the city, they made a request for us to come back. So our plan is to come back this year.
People
over the years, each year continue to grow, and the most we've had is 25,000.
Okay.
And they wrapped all the way from
as far as receiving food.
Many years ago, there used to be a man that has passed away since.
You know if they want coffee?
Okay.
So do you remember him?
Yes.
So
nice to meet you. Want coffee?
Yeah.
They were like, you're fluffy.
When he passed away,
okay? Uh-huh. Don't be bashful. Just go over there and smack him upside the head and say, yeah.
Yes, that'd be great.
Hold the room.
Just in case I
need
it. Just in case they need it.
Yeah, it's in there. It's good in there. They worked on it. The whole place last night.
Do they still want it?
You're smaller than he was.
Yeah.
He's a big man.
It was the glass on top of it.
So, we've got favor with the city, and as you see,
yes, we do.
Find out if they want coffee.
Yes.
So that is our goal this year, to go back and press it. And then we, so it's, gosh, I think when we had 25,000 people, we might have had, I don't know, 500 turkeys.
Okay, give me 1 second and I will get you that information, okay?
Rentals, you have to pay for permits, parking fees, all that kind of stuff. Yeah, do a traffic control plan, all that stuff. So it has grown over the years. We're known citywide for that particular event, well known throughout the metro area. And so that continues. Then a second event, a big event that we do each year is called the Christmas Foyer. We also used to do that, we also used to do that the third Saturday of December, and we would do that in front of City Hall. We would rent a, like a horse and carriage to put the kids and the children on it.
Hello?
Same idea with the Christmas toy outreach.
Yeah.
And we would gather donations of toys for inner city children, give those away. The goal would be to have people sign up as early as possible. And then we would have, like this last year, we had it here again because of COVID. We didn't know what we were facing. So the goal is to get it back in town as well. If not, we can hold it here easily. So we would have like a registered line and a non-registered line. And those that were registered would be, of course, come visit. And then those that didn't register would come in afterwards. And we'd always have enough gifts. I think.
So how does that work? Do you gather their toys and then wrap them?
No, we have volunteers come and wrap them, and then we put an age group on the package so we don't know what they're doing.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So it's a surprise.
Yeah, so to be surprised for that. Last year was, or the year before that, was really interesting. We tried to go through some sources that we normally go through, and we weren't able to go through them, so we didn't know what was going to be. Somehow Channel 7 came out, the local news media, and they came down and they took me to Walmart, and they bought all the toys.
Wow, that's amazing.
Yes, and then we're on a website which is called Colorado Gives. .org, so you can see a lot of that video footage on there for children.
Yeah, that'd be actually great.
Our organization.
So what is your name?
So that's another venue for which people can get.
So normally the toy outreach is in front of City Hall.
Yes, but we've had it here for the last couple of years. So we haven't discontinued any of that. We do it whether it's there or whether it's here. The rules,
and all of their rules.
Yeah, and regulations.
Yeah, it just seems to keep growing.
They keep growing.
Are you guys good to take a quick break?
Sure.
Okay.
Can I take your phone number just in case the person was more
careful? I had that. It's horrible.
It's horrible. Yeah. And I've been vaccinated, so I didn't get all the blisters. But I got the band and all these red dots and bruises. It's where all the blisters have been. It's horrible. And I couldn't say no.
Okay. So if you want
to, I was wearing pajamas.
If you want to email him it, you're more than welcome. It's D. Clifton.
Anything that touches certain areas.
Yeah.
Put in like CLIFTON at the world for Jesus.net.
Yeah, I'm still having problems.
And if you got chicken pox, you can have shingles.
So,
but don't be scared.
I'm not scared.
There's a restroom here, and there's a restroom here.
It's just the, so it's a lowercase d.
David Clifton.
Yes,
so let me make sure you got it. So D Clifton, the word, the at sign.
This is
the world for Jesus.net.
This is when we find.
Yeah. Okay. And then his name is David Clifton.
Yeah, and that's where the house.
He is here, but he is in an appointment for a meeting.
Yeah.
He's going to be in an appointment meeting throughout this whole week, so that's why I got your number, just in case he wants to call you personally when he's done with his meeting during the day.
Tell him our associate, a pastor, will call him back.
And then we added, what,
$230,000? Yeah, the total now is $45,000.
If anything else, an associate with pastor will call you.
Okay, so he goes to interest first.
Yeah.
So I'll try to keep that real fast.
Oh, no.
We'll take two.